Hello, in this session we will discuss the non-controlling interests, a concept that's covered in advanced accounting courses as well as the CPA exam. Especially on the CPA exam, it's an important topic because you could be getting multiple choice questions or a simulation to compute non-controlling interests. So in this session, I will explain what is non-controlling interests. Once you understand it will be easier for you to integrate this information into a consolidation problem. So whether you are an accounting student or a CPA candidate, I strongly suggest you take a look at my website, farhatlectures.com. No, I don't replace your CPA review course. You can keep it. I am a useful addition. I explain the material differently. I give you alternative explanation. I give you alternative resources to help you understand concepts such as the non-controlling interest. As a result, you'll be able to understand your CPA review course. As a result, you'll be able to pass. My resources are aligned with your CPA review course. And to try me, you have to risk 1 month of subscription. That's your risk. Your potential gain is passing the exam. Are you willing to take that risk? And if not for anything, take a look at my website to find out how well or not well your university is doing on the CPA exam. Take a look at my other resources for other accounting and CPA courses. If you haven't connected with me on LinkedIn, please do so. Take a look at my LinkedIn recommendation. Like this recording, share it with others. Connect with me on Instagram, Facebook, Reddit, and Twitter. So what is the non-controlling interest? What is this concept? When does it get created or when does it exist? Well, it exists when one company owns more than 50%. It means you have control, but less than 100%. So it's like 50.001 to 99.999%. So you don't own 100%. So why would the company only own between 50 and 100%? There are many reasons why they would do so. I mean, why would you think that's the case? Well, for one thing, you may not have enough funds or stocks to buy the other company. So you can only buy 60% or you can only buy 90% because to buy the other company, you have to have the resources. Well, if you don't have enough resources, then you cannot buy the whole thing. Another reason for this that could happen is not everyone that you are purchasing the stocks from are willing to sell. So some stockholders, they may want to hold. They don't want to sell the company. They don't want to sell their shares, or they might think they're going to get a better price down the road. So if they're not going to sell, you're going to have to account for their interests. And their interests, the people that don't sell, they're called the non-controlling. And sometimes it's called, you might see it in other textbook, they use the word minority. It means they're not the majority. The majority is assumed to be 50% plus. They belong to the minority group. So they don't want to sell. They want to hold out. That's fine. Okay. Now you have to keep in mind when we consolidate, and you should know this from the previous session, we consolidate the 100% of the company. The control company must always consolidate the whole, regardless of the parent company level of ownership. Well, hold on a second. Are you saying, although I own 60%, I consolidate 100%? And the answer is yes, you do consolidate 100%, but you have to account for something new called the non-controlling interest. So this is basically what it looks like from a physical or from a picture perspective. So you have to have the parent company's asset 100%, the subsidiary's asset 100%, although you own only 80%, the parent's liability will be recorded at 100%, the subsidiary's liability will be recorded at 100%. Parent company ownership equity, which is net asset, 100% of the company, you're gonna account for 80% of the subsidiary's net asset. In addition to that, so not 100% of the net asset of the subsidiary, only 80%. Notice here. In addition, you're gonna have something new on the balance sheet called non-controlling interests, and this goes under the equity section of the balance sheet. No, it goes under the equity section. Okay. And we have to account for the 20%. Why 20%? Because we only own 80%. 20% of the subsidiary net assets. So now we have to account for their assets on our balance sheet in the equity section. And don't worry, we're going to work an example seeing how this all flows through. All what we have to learn in this session is what is non-controlling interest? How do we compute non-controlling interest? Remember a few things you have to be aware of. One is 100% of the assets and liabilities are listed on the balance sheet, as I just showed you. Non-controlling interest is at fair value, computed at fair value. And if we have goodwill, we have to record the goodwill, whether we have a gain or a bargain purchase. Now, when we buy a company, when a parent company buys a subsidiary, so how do we account? How do we find out what is the proceeds? How do we find out how much did we pay for this? Well, we're going to pay for two things when we buy a company. We're going to pay for the fair value of the controlling interest. Obviously, we're going to have to pay for this, and we have to find out the fair value of the non-controlling interest. So those two components, the sum of those two components, okay, it's going to give you the firm fair value. The fair value of the controlling interest and the fair value of the non-controlling interest. Now, if the sum of these two, if the sum exceeds the collective fair value, so if the sum of those two things exceed the fair value of the net identifiable asset and liabilities, then you have goodwill. And guess what? If not, then you have a bargain purchase. If the collective fair value of the identifiable net assets and liabilities are greater than the fair value, then the acquirer recognizes a gain. Simply put, you either have a gain or a goodwill, and you should know how to do this from the prior session. Now, the best way to illustrate this is to work an example to show you how do we account, how do we create non-controlling interest. So assume the parent company pays $50 per share for 9,000 shares of a sub. And let's assume that represent 90% interest. So simply put, the sub has 10,000 shares. We purchased 9,000, which is what remain is 1,000. So we purchased 90%. Also assume that the remaining 1,000 non-controlling interests continue to trade at $50. So we paid $50 for the stock that we purchased. And the non-controlling interest, the people that did not sell also paid, also their shares also is trading at $50. Why is that relevant? That's relevant because here we did not pay a premium. So we were able to buy 9,000 shares at $50, and the remaining shareholders are trading their stocks at $50. Now let's find out what is the fair value of the sub. Well, the fair value will be we purchased 9,000 shares at $50, 450. That's the fair value of the controlling interest. We have to find out the fair value of the non-controlling interest, which is $50 per share times 1,000 shares, 50,000. The acquisition date fair value is $500,000. Now let's assume the company have a net identifiable asset that we are purchasing at 400,000. What does that mean? It means we paid more. The fair value is worth more than the book value. What do we have to do now? We have to allocate, and specifically it's the, we have a goodwill of 100,000, just in case you're not aware of this, because the fair value is $500,000, the book value is 400,000, we have goodwill. Now what we have to do, we have to allocate this goodwill to the controlling and non-controlling interest. Now how do we do? So let me show you how do we allocate the goodwill. We have 90% controlling interest and 10% non-controlling interest. The acquisition fair value, the date fair value of the parent is 450. The acquisition date fair value of the non-controlling interest is 50, total of 500,000. Now we have to find out the book value. The book value of the whole company, the net book value, net identifiable asset is 400,000. 90% is for the 90% of it goes to the controlling interest, allocated to the controlling interest. So 450 minus 360, the goodwill of the 100,000, 90,000 goes to the controlling interest. Then the non-controlling interest, they have a fair value at the acquiring date of 50,000. The fair value of the net identifiable asset is 40,000, which is 400,000 times 10% their interest. 50 minus 40 equal to 10,000. So notice here, the 100,000, the goodwill, was allocated proportionally, 90% to the controlling interest, 10% to the non-controlling interest. Now this happens, I'm going to tell you this why, because we did not pay a premium. Simply put, we paid $50 and the non-controlling interest, their stock is valued at $50. That's not always the case, which we're going to see in the next example, that it may not be the case. Here, there is no premium. We did not pay any premium, so the goodwill is recognized proportionally. Now, let's change the scenario a bit and assume that the parent company pays a control premium to purchase the parent the sub, and they end up paying, rather than $50, they end up paying $55. So to buy the 9,000 shares, they end up paying $55 per share. In other words, they paid $495,000. Well, this $495,000 is greater than 45%, 45,000, not 45%, 45,000 than the prior price of $50 per share, the 450. Now we're going to assume that the remaining shares of this company are kept trading at $50, $50 per share. So they were not affected. Now, what's the fair value of the sub at the acquisition? Well, the fair value consists basically of two different figures. In other words, 9,000 shares were purchased at $55, which are worth $495,000. The remaining 1,000 shares, they kept on trading for $50. Now, in the real world, that doesn't happen, but we're going to assume that's the case. For private companies, it could happen because they don't want to sell and no one wants to buy their shares. Therefore, they will keep trading at 50. They're worth 50,000. All in all, the fair value of the acquisition company is 545,000. Now, remember in the from the prior slide, we said that the net identifiable asset is 400,000. So we have a goodwill here of 145,000. Now we're going to allocate the goodwill to the controlling interest and to the non-controlling interest, what we did in the prior, on the prior slide. How do we do so? Well, the fair value of the controlling interest, 495. If we take 400,000 times 90%, that's going to give us 360. 495 minus 360, we're going to allocate 135,000 to the controlling interest goodwill. The non-controlling interest, the fair value is 50. 400,000 times 10% is 40,000. It's 10,000. So notice here, the goodwill is not distributed proportionally. Okay, simply put, we did not take the 145, gave 90% to the controlling and 10% to the non-controlling. We did not do that. Obviously, if you want to know the percentage, I can show you percentage wise. 135 divided by 145, the controlling interests, this represent around 93, I'm just going to round it, 93%, approximately 93%, and this account for 7% of the goodwill, okay? 7%, together 100%, which is represent 145. Well, the reason is basically, if you really think about it, the difference between if we look at this number, 135 goodwill, and the prior example where we paid the same amount, same amount for both the controlling and non-controlling, we come up with 90,000. So the difference between 90,000 and 135, the difference between 135, the goodwill now when we pay a premium, and 90,000 when we did not pay a premium, equal to 45,000, which is, if you remember, I told you we paid a premium of 45,000. Therefore, the premium that we paid is allocated entirely to the controlling interest, because we're valuing the controlling interest. We paid the premium for the controlling interest. Therefore, the non-controlling interest should not be allocated any goodwill. And hopefully this makes sense. If I'm valuing you at a higher rate, I'm going to have to give my investment a higher goodwill. Now, the non-controlling interest was still trading at how much? At $50. So I hope by looking at this recording, you'll understand a little bit better the concept of non-controlling interest and how do we compute non-controlling interest. Now, this is the beginning. We're going to have to allocate income to the non-controlling and controlling interest. We're going to have to account for dividend. We're going to have to account for the ending balance of the non-controlling interest. But again, at the end of this recording, if you like this recording, all what I'm going to ask you to do is subscribe. Give my material a chance. I can help you pass the exam. In addition to your CPA review course, I cannot help you pass the exam by myself. You need additional resources. I don't have everything, but I have enough that I can be a boost to your CPA preparation. My material is aligned to go with your course. Keep your course. Get this extra vitamin pill that's going to help you succeed. Good luck. Study hard, and of course, stay safe. Invest in yourself. The CPA is a long-term investment.